I hope everybody's ready for Christmas. Are you, is it something to get ready for?
Well, you know, I'm sort of on my way there, but I've kind of decided that just enjoying the season and the reason is what it's all about.
Season and reason, that's the answer, and I'm hoping to get away and do a little praying. But
yes.
I suppose we all ought to pray. We've got a government. Apparently, Congress is broken. The budget compromise is facing an uphill battle in the Senate. Senate Democrats use the nuclear option to blow up any remaining traces of bipartisan spirit in that august body.
Well, while some say that this deal is a first step toward finding common ground, others say it shows there really is none. Gary Lane reports.
Members of the Republican-controlled House gave overwhelming approval to the budget plan.
Our job is to find enough common ground to move the ball down the field on behalf of the American people who sent us here to do their work.
But supporters of the deal may need a Hail Mary pass to win in the U.S. Senate. Tea Party members oppose the agreement because it does little to address the issues of entitlements and out-of-control spending. The nation's debt now stands at more than $17 trillion. And there's the increasingly ugly atmosphere in the Senate. Senate Democrats recently invoked the so-called nuclear option, changing Senate rules to prevent Republican filibusters of President Obama's judicial nominees. Even some Democrats say the nuclear option has poisoned the atmosphere in the higher chamber and created a somewhat dysfunctional, uncooperative Senate. Meanwhile, former Republican Senator Alan Simpson warned Congress still needs to tackle the bigger problems, calling the budget deal a sparrow belch in the midst of a typhoon. Bob Bixby of the Bipartisan Concord Coalition said the president calls it a good first step, but to what? One of the main architects of the proposed budget, House Republican Paul Ryan, said Congress will be asked to revise the tax code next year. Appearing on Meet the Press Sunday, Ryan defended the deal.
And I know what I think is the right thing to do. Getting a budget agreement that reduces the deficit without raising taxes and prevents two government shutdowns from occurring in 2014, in my opinion, is the right thing to do.
Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid says he'd like to see a vote within the next several days. That way, members of the U.S. Senate can be home for Christmas. But Bixby says if it passes, few Americans will get excited. It's a little bit like a child bringing home a D on a report card, he says, instead of an F. Gary Lane, CBN News.
Thanks, Gary. This Obama thing is going to get worse and worse, apparently. We haven't begun to see your health insurance is going to maybe double or triple. The availability of doctors is going to shrink dramatically. The whole concept of health care is going to be destroyed in America. The unintended consequences of this monstrous piece of legislation, the president hadn't read it, the congressmen haven't read it, hardly anybody has read the dumb thing, and they all passed it because that was what the socialists or the progressives wanted. And they've inflicted this thing on Americans. It's just insane. It is just going to cause more pain than you could imagine. Have you heard stories about people who are suffering?
Well, I think they're on the news every day.
Yeah.
And then all of this at the same time that the baby boomers are coming into retirement years and health
needs. It's terrible.
It's just crazy.
Well, I mean, but the whole idea is that the younger people are going to have to paid maybe double of what they normally would pay. They've got to pay for maternity welfare. They've got to pay for, prosthetic devices for the elderly and stuff like that. And they've got to have insurance on that, and they don't want it.
Yeah.
And so they're not going to sign up. They'd rather take a penalty. And this is going to be a hit. A lot of people aren't going to be hiring. The amount of unemployment's going to go up. This is a monster. And it's going to hurt every one of us. And so, I don't know what to say. You're speechless when you think of anything as monstrous as this being jammed through the Congress, and it didn't have any bipartisan support. Not one Republican voted for this thing. Well, Americans are getting more and more worried about the impact from that Obamacare, as I've said, and John Jessup has more details.
Well, Pat, as you said, Americans are concerned that Obamacare will drive up their health care costs across the board. A new AP-GFK poll shows workers who already have health insurance blame President Obama's health care law for their rising premiums and deductibles. 69% say their annual premiums are increasing, and about 4 out of 5 of those polled say it's because of the president's law. Well, a federal judge has struck down key parts of Utah's polygamy laws, saying they are unconstitutional. The restrictions were challenged by the polygamous family of the TLC show Sister Wives. The judge cited freedom of religion in his decision. He says a provision in Utah law forbidding cohabitation with another person violates the First Amendment. While the ruling does not legalize multiple marriages, it does mean polygamous families who live together cannot be prosecuted. Pat?
I said it a long time ago. There were people in the Congress who said it a long time ago. It has come to pass exactly what we said. Supreme Court ruling homosexuality, for example, laws against them are unconstitutional. The next thing we said would be laws against polygamy would be unconstitutional. And this is the first step. And I don't know whether they call it polyamory and these other, they've got all kinds of names for these relationships, but whatever it is, it's going to be Katie bar the door. Anything. I think multiple marriages, how can you have a law forbidding a couple? They say, well, they love each other. They want to have more wives, and they love all these women. And how can you keep them from doing it? If you say two men that love each other can get married, then why can't a man that loves five women get married to all of them? Why? What's the rationale? Well, there is none, and therefore, what you're going to find is that these laws are going to fall one after the other, and we will have polygamy in America legalized. John?
Pat, federal prosecutors are heading to a grand jury this week with a case of a homegrown jihadist who plotted to blow up an airport in Kansas. 58-year-old Terry Lee Lowen is accused of planning to bomb Wichita's mid-continent airport, rather. He was an avionics technician there. Agents say he spent months planning the attack, studying the airport layout and flight schedules. Lowen allegedly planned a suicide car bombing. He reportedly was radicalized after reading Islamic extremist material on the internet.
We've seen this time and time again. Since 2009 in particular, dozens of arrests on American soil of young, usually young American Muslims. Big, big problem. We see plot after plot. Look, we've had great law enforcement work, Wendy, and a lot of luck, quite frankly. Mm-hmm. Think back to the Times Square bombing in May 2010. The bomb didn't go off. Underwear bomber, Christmas 2009, the bomb didn't go off. So some luck there as well, but a very, very persistent threat. And by the way, this suspect in this Wichita plot was an employee of the airport, Wendy. He had a security card which granted him access to sensitive areas. This is a jihadist dream to have that kind of access.
Lowen now faces multiple charges, including trying to provide material support to a foreign terrorist group. Well, the Mideast is still recovering today from a huge winter storm that blanketed much of the region with snow. As Chris Mitchell reports, the rare storm brought danger to some, but blessings to others.
The worst blizzard to hit the region in more than 50 years dumped nearly 20 inches of snow on Jerusalem over 3 days.
It's unbelievable. It's nice. We have drought. You need water. See? So it's very important to have snow and have water.
The historic storm stranded thousands of motorists on their way to Jerusalem. More than 35,000 Israeli homes were without power, some for days. But for many Jerusalemites, they were days of fun without work or school.
I guess I never really thought I'd ever have a snowball fight in the old city, but there you go.
Because it's fun and you miss school and everything. You can make snowmans and eagles.
Monday was the fourth day that schools were closed in Jerusalem and elsewhere in Israel as lingering snow turned to ice on highways. Piles of snow and downed trees were everywhere. When it snows in Jerusalem, it's usually gone within a day or two. But these cars in one of the city's side streets have been abandoned and stranded for nearly 5 days. In Gaza, thousands of residents were evacuated from their homes due to flooding. Probably the hardest hit was some of the more than 2 million Syrian refugees in Lebanon, Jordan, and elsewhere, many of them living in tents. In Israel, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu said, thanks to security and rescue forces, many lives had been saved.
The state of Israel is coping very well with the great storm. I believe that we perform better than advanced countries that are hit more frequently by such storms, and we see the results.
Despite the dangers, many enjoyed the wonder of seeing the city of Jerusalem shrouded from what the Bible calls the treasuries of snow. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Volunteers placed more than 500,000 wreaths on the graves of America's war veterans this weekend. The event is carried out by a group called Wreaths Across America. At Arlington Cemetery alone, about 25,000 volunteers, friends, and family members placed remembrance wreaths on the headstones of more than 143,000 veterans.
I think the enormity of this place is a very humbling experience.
Just how much that he's missed and how much he's done for us and just how much he's loved.
This really is a sign of respect.
This is the 22nd year the group has decorated cemeteries across the country and marks the largest number ever delivered. Well, new rumors about the anonymous diner who has been leaving generous tips at restaurants across the country. Some reports say it's a former executive at PayPal, but that's unconfirmed. What we do know is that every tip is signed with a simple phrase, "Tips for Jesus." Lori Johnson has that story.
According to the mystery man's Instagram account, he's, quote, doing the Lord's work one tip at a time. One of his latest stops, Moondog's Bar in Port Orchard, Washington.
It's very unique, you know, it's like lightning strike.
The staff of Moondog says a stranger at the end of the bar rang up a $576 check after buying everyone around. Then he left a $5,000 tip.
Are you sure this is what you want to do? And the guy goes, absolutely, you know, I've made a ton of money in my life. This is my way of giving back.
The tip was divided up among all the staff, each person getting $500.
Well, I have two little girls, so they're going to get a good Christmas this year.
This isn't the first time the mystery tipper has struck. He also left a $500 tip on a $25 check in Hollywood, California. He also left a $3,000 tip on a $90 check in Ann Arbor, Michigan. And the list goes on. Some regular customers of Moondog's say those at the restaurant deserve it. Every year they give away free holiday meals to people in need.
This last Thanksgiving we gave 330 meals out.
No one knows who the mystery tipper is or where he'll go next, but it's sure to show up on his Instagram account, Tips for Jesus. Lori Johnson, CBN News.
Well, that's certainly one way to spread the Christmas cheer. Pat, should we inquire about your recent travels and whereabouts?
I'm not sure if we should.
We are mom.
We are mom. Totally mom. All right.
The Colorado teen who shot and critically injured a classmate Friday is being described as an opinionated socialist. That's what fellow students told the Denver Post. The Arapahoe County Sheriff's Office says 18-year-old Carl Pearson apparently wanted to settle a score with his high school debate coach. He shot two students before killing himself last Friday. Hundreds of kids and their parents attended a CBN children's event at a major theater in Thailand. It was the Thai premiere of Superbook in Chiang Mai. The episode, The First Christmas, was screened twice to an audience totaling about 800 people. The story presents the real meaning of Christmas and also emphasizes the Christian value of giving to others as God has given so much to us. Children were also given gifts of cutout and color nativity sets and a gospel cartoon booklet. Well, you can find out more about what CBN is doing around the world by logging on to cbn.com/international.